see a revolution somehow. And I'm lost in your freedom, and this world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. And make the darkness high. My life is dead, I need a resurrection somehow. And I'm lost in your freedom, and this world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Your God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. And fire fall, come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall, come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall, come shake the ground with the sound of revival. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. He rolled the stone away. I'm alive because he lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends.
Hey!
Son was dead, the Savior of the Lord has fallen. His body on the cross, His blood pour out for us, the weight of every curse upon Him. As heaven looked away, the Son of God lay down in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, sing a church. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb has overcome. High. Forever He is risen, He is alive, He is alive. Forever He is glorified, forever He is lifted high. Thank you. most beautiful among thousands and thousands. My beloved, the most beautiful among thousands and thousands. We are marvelous in my spirit with millares y millares, mi amado es el más bello entre millares y millares. Yeshua, my beloved is the most beautiful among thousands and thousands.
Amen. Amen. Good morning. I think I was 13 years of age, could have been 15, somewhere around in that age group. I was singing in a choir in the church that I grew up. And one of the songs says, "Ask me how I know. Ask me how I know." And here's what it said. "Ask me how I know he lives, because he lives within my heart." I'll never forget those lyrics as long as I live, because it taught me more theology than any Bible I'd read up until that point. I knew he lived because the Bible said that. But to know that he could live because he's evidence in your life is an entirely different thing. There are people who know that history is real. They believe in it. So much so that they love repeating it over and over and over, right? Every generation tends to repeat things rather than learning from the previous generation. Well, we know that this is the day. It's not one day a year. It's every day of every year that we get to resurrect and celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? You may be seated for just a moment. We're going to tithe and offer in just a second. But I wanted to share something with you just to let you know that we know how to do Easter around here in every building that we've ever been in. We've been in the Casting Center. We've been here. We've been in other buildings. And we know how to do that no matter where we are, because we're not caught off guard by our location or things that happen to us. However, that's not true in a lot of churches. It's not true in a lot of denominations. I read an article not too long ago about an outbreak that had happened in a particular city that totally disrupted the Christian community of that city. The outbreak wasn't that people were trying to go to church. Squirrels got in the church. And so the Presbyterians met with the presbytery and decided, what are we going to do with all these squirrels that are coming to church? How are we going to get rid of these squirrels that are getting all in our facility? And they met and they prayed, they fasted, they prayed, and they decided it was predestined for the squirrels to come to church. They were going to leave them alone. It was just God's divine will. So the Baptists met and decided they were going to decide, what are we going to do with all these squirrels coming? And they noticed that the squirrels were particularly fond of the baptistry. So they made a slide and a ladder so the squirrels could get up on the slide and down into the water, thinking that the squirrels would drown. But they knew how to swim, so more squirrels came. So they decided, we don't need to do that anymore. So the Lutheran church got together and they decided, how are we going to do this? And they said, you know, it would be inhumane of us to hurt any of God's creatures, because all of God's creatures are important. And so they trapped the squirrels and took them to the Baptist church. The Episcopalians tried as much as they could do to be unique. So they set traps around the church with whiskey. And they found out that drunk squirrels make more of a problem than saved squirrels. And so they took the whiskey up and they ran back to the Baptist church. Then the Catholics decided on the squirrels and said, we're just going to make them Catholics. And they only showed up on Sunday and Easter and Christmas. Right? And then they finally met with the Jewish leader. And he said, why do you all have a squirrel infestation? And they said, well, we circumcised the first one and we've never seen them back. There's a lot of things you can do to get people to come, and there's a lot of things you can do to get people to leave. We just are delighted that you decided to come and worship with us today, and I trust that what you're going to hear today is going to absolutely radically transform your life. There are only two messages a year that I struggle with. Today is not one of them, but usually it is Easter and Christmas. But today's not one of them, because I've heard from heaven like I've never heard before. I'm going to start a message series today called Up. And I don't know about you, but I remember that little children's movie that came up called Up. It was one of the most delightful movies I've ever seen in my life. It was just incredible. And I couldn't think about what can happen when you just learn the power of the word up. U-P, up, up. Do you know that you can't get up without up? You can't rise up without up? You can't grow up without up? up is so important in your life that it is a very, very biblical word. In Genesis chapter 4, I'm not preaching right now. I'm just telling you what I'm about to do. In Genesis chapter 4, it says, if you do well, your countenance will be lifted up. Have you ever seen somebody who walks around like this? Like they're trying to find pennies on the floor? It's the countenance is down. But buddy, when you've got confidence, you got courage, you got conviction, you got passion, your shoulders are back, your head's up firm, and you're looking ahead because you know out there is the divine destiny of your life. God knows that. And he's told us, all of us, don't let circumstances and situations get you down because he's come to lift you up. And so we're going to tithe, we're going to offer, and then I'm going to teach you a word straight out of today's message of why we came to celebrate Easter on the power of up. Today I'm going to talk to you about you'll never go up if you can't show up. Could you imagine not showing up for your wedding? Could you imagine deciding, I don't think I'm going to hospital to have this baby? There's a lot of things that happen if you're not where you're supposed to be when you're supposed to be there. And there's a lot of things that can't happen if you're not where you're supposed to be. Amen? Let's stand together. We're going to tithe. We're going to offer. And then I'm going to teach you something today. God, we love you. We're thankful for the opportunity you've given us to worship today. Thank you for the opportunity we have to be in this house, in this place. God, we're grateful for what you're doing in our midst. We're grateful for the revelation. We're grateful for the way in which you're speaking to us. And we pray that you'll continue right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give. Turn the arrow up and down. Amen. Thank y'all very much. If you've got your Bibles, I want you to begin to turn to Matthew's version of today's story in Matthew 28. It's going to come up on the screen here in a few moments. I want to talk to you for a moment just about the word up. Two letters that make something so powerful. What is it that gets you up? What is it that gets you out of bed? I know a lot of people have to have an aid to get out of bed. I'm not talking about a crane. I'm talking about something that motivates them to get out of bed. And the more discouraged you get, and the more depressed you get, the more down you get, the harder it is to get out of bed. I've known people who I've worked with in my ministry through the years who had a hard time getting out of the house. It wasn't that they were just afraid of the world. They just didn't want to leave their house. They were comfortable inside their house. I've known people who were comfortable so much so in their job, they couldn't even entertain another job, a better job, one that had more money attached to it, more benefits with it. But they didn't like change, so if they didn't like change, they couldn't change from the place where they were to go up in life. I don't know what motivates you, but I do know that most people are motivated in one or two directions. It's either internal, or some would call it intrinsic, or it's external. I would say it's either internal or it's eternal. If you're looking at the inside of you only and to what is in it for you, then you make decisions out of all the S words you know in your vocabulary. What's in it for self? It's selfish. It's self-centered. But if you're looking at the eternal as to what is going to happen in eternity, you begin to make decisions quite differently. We all know, if you grew up in this area, enough of the Bible that would say, lay not up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and thieves, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust nor thieves can get. Have you ever thought about what we're laying up? Have you ever thought about what we're sowing up? Have you ever thought about what you got to do to give up so you can give up what you need to give up? Internal or eternal? I don't know about you, but some people from those two perspectives need the motivation of an achievement. I'm always interested in this time of the year where athletes are on showcase everywhere. Baseball's going, football's going, gymnastics is going. All of those things that, yeah, basketball's going. Woohoo, LSU. And so all of these things are going on right now with all these different sports, and they're on showcase, but nobody's watching them when they're not on showcase. But it's when they're not on showcase is what determines whether they're up in the poll or up in the court or up in the category of best and elite or not. Well, it's the same for the Christian life. There are a lot of people who need the extra motivation because God's not enough motivation. There are a lot of people who need the dog and pony show, and the dog and pony show have to keep going over and over and over because the resurrection show is not enough. No, don't get offended. Just listen for a moment. Because I'm going to tell you that if you're one of those that need external motivation because the eternal motivation is not enough, you're on good grounds and you're in good company. The Bible says in Matthew 28 and verse 1, it was a day just like today. In fact, it's called the Sabbath, the first day of the week. It began at dawn, and Mary Magdalene and Mary, the other Mary, and then, of course, if you read Mark's version, Salome came with them, three women that left to go to the tomb, and they weren't going there to see an earthquake. They weren't going there to see a resurrection. We know from all the Gospels they were going there because they had these spices that they weren't able to anoint the body of Jesus for death, and they were going to anoint him. Even though he had said, strike this body 3 days later, and not one of the people who for three solid years heard him promise what he promised got up that day expecting. Not one of them rose up and couldn't sleep in the middle of the night going, I can't wait, I can't wait, I can't wait till dawn. I can't wait till sunrise. I can't wait because I know he's going to do what he says he's going to do. Not one. An earthquake had occurred, and an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat on it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. The guards shook for fear and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, don't be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here. What a powerful word. Wouldn't it be interesting if there would be a period there? He is not here. Well, where'd he go? Well, I don't know. He is not here, for he has risen. Here's the most powerful. Just as he said. Amen. I wanted to. And you know, I'm not trying to be facetious. I'm trying to be honest. The Lord and I have these dialogues, and he tends to win most of the time. But if I would have named this message what I wanted to, it would have been just as he said. Amen. Because I found in my life, he does what he says. He does what he says in spite of me. He does what he says because of me. He does what he says regardless of me. He does what he says. But rather to understand that for him to do what he says, somebody's got to go where they're supposed to go, and somebody's got to do what they're supposed to do, and God certainly has to do what he says he's going to do, because that's the way it works. So they quickly left to go tell his disciples. And on their way back, they see him. And as they left the tomb, verse 8, quickly with fear and joy overcame them to report to the disciples. And Jesus met them and greeted them. They came and they took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go take word to my brethren to leave for Galilee. And there they'll see me." There they'll see me. I don't know where you've been in your Christian walk. I don't know where you are today in your Christian walk. But I can tell you this. There were times where I was supposed to be exactly where I was supposed to be, and I got to see what I was supposed to see. And there are other times where I wasn't where I was supposed to be. Somebody else was there, and they told me what I would see, but I had to go somewhere else to see it. Because it had already happened there. You see, let's put yourself in the place of these people who for 3 years they had prayed with him. They had fasted with him. They had walked miles with him. They had seen miracles with him. They had had him lay hands on them and give them power to even lay hands on others to where sickness and disease came out. And every day he's teaching them. Every day he's feeding them. Every day he's leading them. Every day he's talking to them about what is to come. Every day they're hearing, every day they're questioning, every day they're receiving, every day they're being taught. And then on the day where all of their teaching is to come to fruition, they had given up. They weren't in a hurry to get up. They had given up. They weren't in a hurry to go because they had already felt like they lost. Because you see, they were there, they saw what took place. And no one had ever taken the beating like he had. I'm not a person who can take trauma very well. I'm not a person who can take drama very well. And when The Passion of the Christ came out, Lara wanted to go see it. And so we sat in the very back of the movie theater where nobody could see me. And I was crushed the entire time. From the moment it started, it did a number on me where I can just talk about it and it breaks me up because I now visually had to see on a movie screen what I had visually only seen in my brain. I had imagined what it was like, but they described what it was like with a lot of research. And once you get that image in your head, it's hard to get it out. Lara did a great job through the years of raising our children and protecting them from seeing things they shouldn't see, hearing things that they shouldn't hear. We kept remote controls close to us so that when the commercials changed, the TV could go off or the sound could go down so they wouldn't get caught seeing something that we never wanted them to be exposed in. We postponed it as long as we could because they weren't age-appropriately prepared to deal with it. I wonder today how many Christians are age-appropriate to deal with the fact that he is who he says he is, he did what he said he would do, and he's done what he said he would do, and he still promises he'll do it for you. What in the world could happen between 3 years of hearing, seeing, watching, listen to me, and sensing everything miraculous around your life? That from a late Friday evening to an early Sunday morning, everything you believed in is as if it never happened. It's a confrontive statement, isn't it? To have to deal with the fact, oh my gosh, how many times have I not shown up, but I expect him to show up whenever I want him to show up? How many times have I begged him to do something? And how many times have I ignored him when he wanted me to do something? It's just an amazing thing to think about that they had experienced supernatural, super phenomenal. They had been set free and experienced peace like never before. It could never be ignored. It was not a dream. It was not something they would wake up from. There is no explanation as to why they didn't get up and go. But we're better than them. We're way better than them. We have explanations. Oh, well, it's too early. Oh, it's too late. It's every week. Are you kidding me? So-and-so's coming over. Are you kidding me? So-and-so invited me to go so-and-so. Oh, are you crazy? I've got to do this. I got to do that. We have explanation where they're sitting there giving no explanation. But the ladies stepped up to do the job, stepped up to finish the job, even in the midst of discouragement, even in the midst of being down, even in the midst of being disturbed. They wanted to finish the task, but they still had lost their expectation. I wonder how many Christians in America today, I don't need to know the answer to this because I know the statistics, have lost the expectation that God is even in control anymore. The pandemic alerted us to the fact that we only did what we did because it was convenient. And the moment somebody gave us an excuse to not go, we said we wouldn't. There wasn't Christians banging on doors. Open up, open up, open up. It was the excuse of all excuses, the government said. Don't get condemned. I'm going somewhere. Hang with me. All of these things that they didn't have, we now have and live with every day of our life. So I want to give you something else to live with. I want to give you something that's worth getting up for. I want to give you something that's worth growing up for. I want to give you something that's worth rising up for, showing up for. Because I'm telling you, every one of you in this place, including me, has watched something on video. And then you post it and repost it and repost it and repost it because it moves you of the video. But I don't know if you've ever been there when it really happened. I wasn't in the stadium when Whitney Houston sang. I wasn't there, but I was standing in my living room, and I'm telling you, I've never had anybody who could reduplicate what she did with a national stadium at a Super Bowl and singing God Bless America and or the national anthem. I know what rose up on my hands, my arms, the back of my neck. Oh, no, I didn't say my head because I looked just the same way then as I do now. On my legs, I got hair on my legs. I know what it was like. I know what it was like to have someone sing with such an anointing that she could sing with. And it was as if I was there just by watching it live, not Memorex, not CD, not digital. Can you imagine what it must have been like to have been there that day and to see something that has never been seen? Listen, the disciples had seen someone come back from the dead. Amen. You remember this, right? Jesus called Lazarus back from the dead. But they had never seen an empty tomb with nobody else in it. They'd never seen any. I remember growing up in the church I grew up in Birmingham, preacher one time getting all hut and bothered and everything else, and he said, and Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth. And then he said, y'all want to know why he called Lazarus? He said, because if he would have just said, come forth, everybody would have come out. It's good to think about. But the truth of the matter is they'd all had to go back in eventually because only one has risen from the dead to never die again. And so I'm going to encourage you today to think about listening to the resurrection story from a whole different perspective today to say, I want to show up because I want to see what nobody else has seen. Do you know we live in a world that loves statistics today? You can give you the statistic of how many children are going to end up doing this if parents do this. You can have a statistic of how many people are going to be healed from this if you do this. And I'm not talking about healed supernaturally. I'm talking about just take this and this will happen. Take this pill and that'll happen. Take this pill and that'll happen. We're the most gullible society in the world that'll listen to anybody with a promise that we can lose weight. I could tell you how to lose weight in 40 days, guaranteed. Fast. You'll lose a lot of weight. And it's not going to hurt you spiritually. 3 days, you can do the same thing. 5 days, you can do the same. 10 days, you can do. But see, we want something that'll say, give me the cake without calories. At our house, we bless them out. As you can tell, it ain't working. Is to understand, you come to the place in your life to go, I want to see something that I've never seen before in my life. And the reason why I've never seen it is because it might be I wasn't there to see it. But I want to remind you, if you're not there to see it, you are resolved. You are determined to live with what somebody else said. Now, lifers, you know this because I've been asking you for a long time. Who in your life, when they tell you something, you believe it without any shadow of doubt? Who do you have in your life that you've got 100% confidence in that if they tell you, it's so? I've met very few people who have said, I believe it because he said it. Because most of us are like Thomas. Unless we see, unless we touch, unless we put our hands in the side, we're not going to believe he's really real because we don't see any evidence of it. But yet you and I are supposed to be walking around on the face of the earth as the evidentiary fact that Jesus is no longer in the grave. They shouldn't have to go to a tomb. They should be able to see our life. They shouldn't have to see a rock because our hard head is hard enough. Listen, I know who I'm preaching to today. And I know it's the choir, so to speak, is to understand you're here, you believe in this. But I just want to remind you, what is it that could convince you it might not be true? It might be debatable. Now, before you say nothing, just remind yourself. Hebrews says in chapter 10 and verse 25, do not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. But ministers all over our nation stood up and said, with the pandemic, don't assemble yourself. And most people listened. Is there a reason why they would doubt the resurrection? I mean, he only came back from the grave, but sickness and disease, that's 50-50. I mean, which is it harder? To resurrect the dead or to take care of the sick? If you were to come to my yard, I've been getting ready to raise the dead, and I've started with grass. I'm doing my best to try to get that grass to come back, and it ain't cooperating some places in my yard. Some people say, well, you don't have enough water. Some people say you got too much sand. Some people say you need more sun. Man, I've tried everything in the world. I'm just going to tell you, I'm of the opinion there's got to be gravel under my dirt somewhere. And ain't deep enough. It's to understand that if God says we can do it, why isn't he doing it? And why don't we believe he can do it to where we see it over and over and over and over in our life? It's not the fact that he won't do it. And I'm not going to say it's the fact that we don't believe it. I'm going to tell you that most of the time it's because, listen, we won't receive it. John 8, verse 36, red letter edition in your Bible, in my Bible, it says that if the Son makes you free, you're free indeed. Everybody's Bible say that? If the Son makes you free, you're free indeed. But you know how many people I know who don't live free? Say, hey, will you do so? Oh, I can't do that. Well, wait a minute, I thought you were free. Well, I'm not free to do that. I'm not free to do that. I had a person sitting in front of me not too long ago, and we're talking, and I'm sitting there. I go, listen, I don't know why you're coming, because you don't listen to what I'm telling you. And I said, oh, I know why you're coming, because I'm free. I said, you see, if I charge you $300 an hour, you either wouldn't come, or you decide, maybe I need to listen to what he says. You see, if Jesus came to set us free, and yet we're more constrained, we're more constricted, we're more confined, we're more controlled by other things than ever in our life, we got to at least think, do we believe in the power of the resurrection? And it's not about factual belief, it's do we believe it enough to receive it in every area of our life? I'm telling you that if we can get up enough courage, if we can get up enough strength, if we can get up enough stamina, if we can get up enough willpower, if we can get up enough courage and chutzpah about us to say, I'm going to believe what he said he believes until I see it happen in my life. And then you become the billboard of the resurrection. We don't have to put him down the street. My son over here lives in New Orleans. And he works on an ambulance. And I'm telling you of the number of people that they can pick up on the streets in the ambulance who have OD'd and who have got drugs on them and on and on and on. None of them have a sign on them that say, take me to the shelter, take me to the so-and-so, take me to the feeding house. The beggars in New Orleans know exactly where to go to find food. And there's no billboard saying, here, free meals. When are we as Christians going to believe that if we can just come together, as he says, and we can believe? How many? Two are. I think the word says he can do quite a few things. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, it's time on Easter Sunday, on Resurrection Sunday, for us to come to the place to where we go ourselves to show up to see what he can do. We meet with two others or three others, or we come together in a place like this to say, I don't know what's going on in my life, and I don't understand why it's going on in my life, and I don't know what in the world's going to happen, but what I do know is that I can't get out of this on my own. I can't get out of this on my own thought. I can't get out of this in my own belief. I need somebody who will agree with me. Let's go to the tomb. Let's go to the place where he said he would do in that place and see if he'll do it in that place. Because if he'll do it in that place, listen to me, he'll do it in this place. Amen. You got to get up to show up so you can see what he can do in your life. I had a lady years ago in my life who came up to me one Sunday. Many years ago, get out of your head, you know who it is, because you don't. And we've been here a long time, but you don't. She came up and she said, Pastor Paul, I just want to tell you, I want to be married so bad. I begged God to give me a husband, and God has not sent me a husband yet, and I just don't know if God will do for me what I'm asking him to do for me. And I said, yes, he will. And I said, dear, listen to me. I believe the Lord wants you to go on a mission trip. Why don't you let us send you to Peru and work in our church in Peru for 3 months? I am not marrying a Hispanic.
I said, I didn't say anything about marrying a Hispanic. I said, why don't you go on a mission trip? I checked just the other day on Facebook. She's still single. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Because if you don't go where God's leading you to go, it's impossible for you to meet who He's designed for you to meet. Now let me tell you a true story. This young man right here was with me when this happened. He wanted to start an orphanage in one of our churches in Peru back many years ago. And so we're in Peru, and we're going from orphanage to orphanage, and I'm in one of the largest orphanages in Peru. And we're walking, and I see a young couple come. I know they're not Peruvian, and I know they're not Jamaican, and I know they're not Australian, because I'm telling you, once I found out where they lived, well, of course. I mean, she was as white as the tiles that you're standing on. And she had, her skin had not seen sun in probably forever. And she was from Colorado. And the next day, she and her husband was over the orphanage that we were going to the next day. Their minds were blown by watching this orphanage as opposed to what they had. Well, walk in, and they start telling me their story. I said, Tony, how in the world did you get here? How'd your mom and dad convince you to come? He said, well, you know, I grew up here. I was born here. And he said, when I went home to America because I wanted to get an education, he said, my senior year, my dad called and he said, Tony, I really believe that God wants you to come to Peru for your last summer in between college. I want you to come spend some time with him. He said, Dad, I am not coming to Peru. I've been over there forever and ever. I'm not coming to Peru. I want to enjoy my summer off. He ended up not doing anything. Next week, not doing anything. Next week, not doing anything. He finally decided, my gosh, I've only got 2 more weeks. I've done nothing. I might as well go see my mom and dad. So he gets on a plane. He flies to Peru. And working in the orphanage is a pale-skinned woman from Colorado. Had been over there for 9 weeks. He looks at her immediately. He goes, oh, my God, why didn't you tell me she was here? Can I just say that God will use anything that He can use to draw you to Him? Amen. And most of the things that He's designed to draw you have been there for a long time, but you won't go investigate it to see it. Everyone I know in here wants to be free, as John 8 says. But we don't want to investigate how to walk in freedom because our puny little brain always goes back to, this is what I know. And we know that if we do what we know, we're guaranteed to get what we know. Now, this is not for you. This is for the people on the camera. So listen very carefully. I deal with a lot of ministers these days who I can start to quote a scripture and they interrupt me and quote the scripture I'm about to quote. And they go, Pastor, I know the word. Don't quote the word to me. I said, sir, it's not that you know the word. It's you don't believe the word. Amen. And it's not that you don't know the word. You don't behave the word. It's good to teach your people the word. But if you don't believe it and you don't behave it, you will never receive it. You understand? These ladies weren't going expecting for the word to manifest that Jesus wasn't there. They just knew that they were supposed to go based on what they knew historically and Jewish culture to anoint the body for death. Because you see, they had forgotten the lady that washed Jesus' feet had already anointed the body for death. Oh, my God, you need to come into this. And you remember, that's what set Judas off. I can't believe I lost out on money because you told her not to go sell that perfume oil and you let her wash your feet with her hair. I now don't have enough money to steal out the pot. And why did Judas become Judas? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm trying to get you to muster up enough courage to say one more time, Lord, I'm going to believe what you say. And I'm going to show up where you say show up so I can get what you say I can get. Amen. Everybody all right? You got a lot of notes on here. Y'all know how to find them. You go to our app and you go down. Listen, if you can't show up to see what you need to see, you will be resorting for the rest of your life living through the eyes of what somebody else saw. Do you know what they call that in the court, in a legal system? When somebody tells you what they saw, or somebody tells you what they heard somebody say, that's called second-hand information. And second-hand information doesn't carry the weight as somebody who said, I was there. You remember the blind guy who couldn't see? And the Pharisees interrogating the blind guy who couldn't see on what he saw when his eyes were open? Well, who did this to you? I don't know. I don't know. He told me to do certain things. I went and did it. When I came back, I don't know who he was. Well, how did he do it? I don't know. Where was he from? I don't know. But then he said, let me tell you what I do know. I once was blind, but now I see. Because he was there to experience it. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm convinced right now, under the anointing of God, not on my life, but on all Christians' life, that if you will believe what he says he can do, you will see him do it in your life. Promise you. Promise you. Promise you. Promise you. Number two, you want to get up and show up. So not only can you see what you need to see, but you want to get up and show up so that you can sense what nobody else can sense. I am not saying the English word S-I-N-C-E, since 2 + 2 = 4. I am using it in the concept that you will sense what God is doing and the awesomeness of what's going on around you. Do you know that it is hard to reduplicate anointing? I was in another country preaching one time through a translator. It was the most difficult thing I'd ever done on this occasion because I was preaching to Quechua people. And as I was preaching to Quechua, I spoke in English. A person in French translated it into Spanish. A person in Spanish translated it back into French. And then the person in French translated it into Quechua. So it's going, good morning. How are you? It's hard to get a flow. Are you hearing what I'm saying? It's hard to get a flow. But there came a point in my message where you could feel that the Holy Spirit came into the room. You could feel that God began to move. And before the translators could do their thing, the people in the room started going, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Because they caught it. They didn't have to be taught it. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'm saying is, when you walk up to that tomb on that day, you didn't have to have an interpreter of what was going on. The earth had moved. The stone was gone. An angel's sitting on there. And fear came upon the guard. You better believe it. And awe came upon the women. You better believe it. Because they've never seen anything like that before. And they sensed a difference. What would it take in your life for God to so move you that you become so unmovable? For God to do such a work that there's nothing that could talk you out of what he could happen in your life. I know, because we've been doing this a long time, that the more hurt you've been, the harder you get. Amen. The harder you get, the more of a hindrance it is for you to surrender the hurt to where the holiness of God can remove that hurt to where you don't even remember it no more. You can't even remember the name of the person who did it. You remember the last words? Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. He wasn't trusting himself with anybody but God. Whose hands have you put your life in? Well, I've met a lot of people who don't go to church because they've been hurt. I'm just telling you, I grew up in the church. If hurt was a request or request requisite to not go to church, I of all people shouldn't go. I got hurt at church by my mama, but I still went home with her. You understand what I'm saying? It's not that somebody did something to you. It's when they did something to you, it did something to you. And when it does something to you, you are eliminating him from doing something to you. And when he can do something to you, he can forgive. He can cause you to forget. He can cause you to forsake it. He can cause you to move on. He can cause you to get behind it. He can cause you to get up and get over it. And it's not a cliche. It's something you go, oh my God, I've waited my whole life to get over that. And in a moment, you're over it. The older that I get, the more I meet parents who their children aren't doing what they want them to do, and now they can't get over what their children's doing because they didn't raise their children that way. Listen to me. Get over it. Amen. The hardest lesson for any parent to learn should be the easiest lesson for every parent to learn, and that is God loves your children way more than you could ever love your children. Yeah, but you don't know my mama. No, I don't. But I knew mine. You don't know my daddy. No, I don't. But I knew mine. I grew up in a home where the brother always got in trouble. Always got in trouble. And when the brother got in trouble, dad didn't like having to get retooled up to do discipline. So he'd just say, come on over here. This is for something you're going to do when I'm not home. Son, go take out the garbage. If you weren't fast enough, whoosh, she would hit you in the back of the head. I learned to duck. I know. I was a junior in high school before I knew my dad as a Christian. I know. The first time I heard my dad say, I'm proud of you. Do not hear somebody who's hurt and offended. I haven't need therapy. I grew up in a loving Christian home. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. The first time I heard my dad say, I'm proud of you, we were at the Shoney's restaurant in Hammond, Louisiana. I had just been ordained into the ministry. My dad had told me how glad he was that I was a good ball player, how good I was on the ball field, how much he loved me over and over. But I never heard him say, I'm proud of you. But the day I was ordained, he looked at me and said, son, I'm proud of you today. I know that some children didn't grow up in a home that could hug and kiss. We do in our home. I know that some kids got hurt by the people who are supposed to protect them. I know. Isn't it amazing why Jesus said in Matthew 9, we're in verse 28, Matthew 28. Isn't it amazing that Jesus said, when you get ready to pray, don't pray to your daddy, don't pray to your mama. You pray our Father who art in heaven. Because when you didn't have it right down here, he wants you to know he's got it right up there. And for you to understand that, you've got to be in the place where you can sense the supernatural is happening in your life. Because very few people can sense this is it. Easter Sunday, I normally tell my testimony at some point in time. This is it. Small version. I was serving a church. I'm 19, 20 years of age. Been in church all my life. I'm sitting in the back of the audience as a youth pastor. I've got 21 of my kids in the youth ministry at the church. A cerebral palsy man. Do not misunderstand what I'm about to do. This man has... incredible in my life. Cerebral palsy man comes up to the stage. He's got a mic wired onto him. He said, I believe my wife needs to tell her testimony. That's the way he preached. I am not making fun. His wife, who had been a Miss America on stage, walks to the podium and she opens the Bible to Matthew. And she quotes this scripture. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father. Thousands of people in the room, and she had a beeline to my face. Conviction hit me like never before. Paul, you've been religious, but you don't have the relationship. And just that fast, we resurrected back into the land of the living. Thank you, Ephraim. So that night, I knew it was my last chance. If I didn't accept Christ that night, I believe I was done. That's just me talking. I can't prove that, but I'm telling you, it scared me that mad. Because you see, I'd been in church all my life. But that night, I sensed something I'd never sensed before. The conviction of the Holy Spirit. Ladies and gentlemen, what would it take for us to get up with that kind of conviction every day of our life and to know, I'm only going to do today, I'm only going to go today, I'm only going to be today what the Lord tells me to be? Because you see, those ladies could sense at the tomb something that everybody else, listen, had to be explained. And you know, when you explain something, it loses something in translation. Amen. Because there's some things you can't explain. Same country, many years ago, I said the same story I said to you about being through four translators. And I'm talking about to the Spanish church is that we have over there. And I'm saying they could not understand what happened in that room because they couldn't find a word to explain it. And I said, what they were missing was the anointing of God. And my Spanish translator, who was from Cuba, dear friend of mine, looks at me and he says, we don't have a Spanish word for anointing. I said, yes, you do. He said, no, we don't. And I looked at that group and I said, necesitas más unción. And they erupted because they knew what the anointing of the unction of the Holy Spirit can do in a room. What we need is somebody who is so sensing the anointing of God in their life that when they come close to us, we sense something different. Listen to me very carefully. Almost every person has this. If you don't think you have it, just go to Walmart. And you walk up to some of the weirdos in Walmart, and I promise you, you're going to sense something. I think I'm going to the other line. It has nothing to do with her tutu she's got on. Have you ever watched those people who go to Walmart? Because we have so learned to sense the things that are bad, we don't know how to sense what God is doing good in our life. Amen. And what we're trying to do is to make sense out of it rather than to receive it as an understanding of what God's about to do in our life. Now, I've got much more to say about this, but you got to get your notes out, and you're just going to have to go home, and you're going to catch this, because I'm going to tell you that if you can't use sense of discernment and yearning of what God's doing, you will miss out on what God is about to do. Through the years at this church, I've given away thousands of dollars at times under the direction of the Lord. Every time I do that, the next week somebody comes up, well, I'd been at church on Sunday if I knew you were going to give out money. I said, oh, well, I'll take out an ad next time. Do you understand? Of course we would be somewhere if we knew what was going to happen when we were there. What these people had to do was to be there because they needed to expect what was going to happen there. And when they couldn't, they had to miss it. And then the women had to say, God wants to see you over in Galilee, and if you'll go there, you'll see him. But you got to go there now to see him. Because now it's not convenient. He was just right down the street from you. Now you got to go over there to see him. Are you following what I'm saying? Are you getting what I'm saying? Listen, if you can't go 1 mile down the road, how are you going to drive 100 miles? Well, we're living in the culture now where we think if it's 100 miles away, it's got more significance than just right down the street. They read from the book, from the law of God, translating to give them the sense so that they could understand what they were reading. Let me give you the sense of what I'm saying, is that if you'll go where God tells you to go so that you can see what God wants you to see, you'll begin to sense what he's going to do in your life that'll change your life and make sense. Number three, almost done. You got to show up if you're going to have something to share. I don't want anybody to take this wrong, and I know people who are sitting here. I know some of the things that you're going through. Do not take this wrong. Right now, our secretary of Life Church, his husband, is losing blood in St. Tammany on what was supposed to be a corrective surgery. It's supposed to be an outpatient thing. He's now had 3 or 4 units of blood. I know people go through stuff. I need you to hear what I'm about to say. I'm not minimizing what we experience in life. What I'm telling you is that unless you experience some things in life, like you may be experiencing right now, you don't understand of what can happen in your life once you've experienced that the next thing you happen has very little effect on your life because of what you just experienced, and God said, I saw you through it. Because he will. I was on a board and hired a guy not too long ago. And in interviewing one of the ladies on the committee said, I want to ask him this question. I want to ask him that question. I said, listen, don't waste your time asking that question. She said, why? She said, I want to know how he's going to respond if so-and-so and such. I said, listen to me. I said, a man's been a policeman. A man's been shot 3 times. The man had cancer and died, and they brought him back to life. He can handle a disgruntled employee. Do you understand? Let me help you. I know what David's got a giant out there. We know the story. He said, oh my God, how did David kill Goliath? Well, he didn't. He killed a lion. He killed a bear. And the same thing that he used to kill the lion is the same thing he used to kill the bear, and it's the same thing he used to kill the giant. And God says, we got something greater than the rock of a pebble to hit in the temple. We got the living word of God in our life. What is sickness and disease? Now, before you go off on a mission, listen to me very careful. I could take you to Galatians today, where Paul is defending his apostolic anointing. The Apostle Paul, not me. The Apostle Paul is defending his apostolic anointing. And he says to them, what happened to you? You used to be with me. You were for me. He said, the only reason why I came to see you the first time is because I was sick. Did you hear me? This is in the Bible. He said, I was physically sick. And I couldn't go any further, so I stayed here. And because I stayed here and was sick, you got to hear the gospel. Do you know there's a group of people out there that believe if you get sick, you're in sin? Cuckoo, cuckoo, cuckoo. God can use whatever he wants to use, but you're going to get over it, and you're going to be stronger once it happens. That's what happens. And the reason why is because you show up at the place where you are. Because you sense that's where God wants you to be, And you begin to see things that are happening like they've never happened before. And you walk out of there and say, let me tell you what happened to me today. Let me tell you what I saw today. Let me tell you what I sensed today. Let me tell you what I experienced today. And it's not because you want somebody to validate it. It's because you want to validate it to somebody else. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. Dikachi, is that you back there? Go to the conclusion, please. All the way down to the conclusion. Whew. You just hold it right on conclusion. Everybody look right here for a minute. The reason why many times when somebody shares something with you, it gets lost in transmission is because you weren't in the place they were in. You weren't in the position they were in. You weren't looking for the purpose they were looking for. Did you hear me? Nobody went expecting the resurrection. They were in the place, but they had missed the purpose. And many times Christians hear something that's happened and they go, I don't believe that. Well, why? No, not affirmation, conclusion. Thank you. And the reason why they missed it is because they came to a place in their life where they're not believing what was said. Listen, the next time somebody says, I don't believe that, say, well, if you would have been there, you'd have believed that. Parents, are y'all listening to me? If you can come to understand that God loves your children more than you do, it'll change the way you pray. Amen. Because sometimes when people can't learn enough that they're willing to grow up, and people can't live enough to grow up, they got to go to a school that's free and cheap but costs you a lot. Amen. The school of hard knocks. Amen. And when you get hard knocks, it knocks you down to where you realize, I'm a little bitty. He's a big, big God. And if you don't think that's not true, stop breathing and try doing it for yourself. Paul, teaching the church at Corinth, said, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus as our Lord? Are you not the work of my handiwork? I said Galatians a moment ago. It was Corinthians. He said, am I not here because of what I did? Then why in the world are you listening to other people who haven't given their life the way I've given my, Paul saying, the way I've given my life for you? Now watch, hang on. Because who would you listen to? Who could get your attention? You remember the parable of the rich man and Lazarus? God, Jesus told the parable that even if one comes back from the dead, they wouldn't believe. So listen, sunshine. If they won't listen to God the Father, and they're not going to listen to God the Holy Spirit, and they're not going to listen to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and they're not going to listen to the anointed word, why are you talking? I got a plaque in my office that says, shutteth, thoueth, uppeth. Because it's not about who's saying it. They're not listening to anything. And the only reason they're going to listen is if something happens in my life, in your life, that radically changes the trajectory of their life. And if they won't listen to the things that happen in our life, they have to experience it themselves. I remember where I was when this happened to me. Lady walks into my office, my children's pastor. She's 66 years of age and she resigned on the spot. I said, I'm not accepting your resignation. She said, you don't have a choice. My husband told me I had to quit. I said, I'm not accepting this resignation. Get your husband in here. I want to talk to him. She said, he's not going to come in and talk to you. I said, oh, well, I'll go out and sit in the car and talk to him. I went out and said, what are you doing? He said, ain't no wife of mine going to tell my pastor what he can do in the children's ministry. I said, dude, are you crazy? I said, I was asking her what she thought about it. I wanted her opinion. There's 200 kids down there in the children's ministry. He said, she's not working here anymore. I walked back into the office. My secretary at the time said, what happened? I told her what happened. She said, I'm going to pray God kills him. I said, listen, before we get drastic, let's pray that he repents. I'm driving from Jackson, Mississippi to Brookhaven, Mississippi. My phone rings. Freddie Rose is in the emergency room at King Daughters Hospital. Get there. I was miles from there, just a few miles from there. I drive in. I bring him to the emergency room. He sees me. They're pumping. They're doing his heart. He's having a heart attack, blah, blah, blah. He motions for me to come in. I busted in the door. Doctor, what are you doing? He said, he's who I need. He said, I repent. Get this off of me. I laid hands on his chest. Perfect sinus rhythm. It wasn't physical. It was spiritual. But you see, you'd have had to been in a room as all those doctors went, what just happened? I didn't need electrodes. I'm not being facetious. What I'm saying is when God decides to do something, you got to be there to experience it, and then you can share it with others because you were there. You were there. And when you have had the resurrection touch your life, you've been there. Go to the next slide, please. Next slide, please. God intends to do such a work in your life that your life will produce evidence of the resurrection of Jesus. But wherever you are, you got to be there. So here's what I know. While I've been preaching, my leg's been lighting up. I got people saying, Happy Easter, Happy Easter, Happy Easter. Everybody that knows me ought to know what I'm doing right now. Did you get this? Will you answer me? Did you get this? No, probably not. But at 2 a.m., I might answer them. See what you're doing later on. It's understand, because you see, we're somewhere, but we're wishing we were somewhere else. We can be somewhere, but we're biding our time until we don't have to be there. Years ago, it was a mentor that said, Paul, if you want to learn how to be successful in life, wherever you are, be there. I can't tell you how many times I've been with people in a conference. I've been with a church where we were having three services. And one person sitting here is there. And the person sitting next to them is going, I wish I wasn't there. And somebody else is there, but somebody else is going, oh my God, I can't believe I gave in to come there. And they walk out having experienced, having seen, having heard the exact thing, but have a different perspective. Amen. Of being there. Hang on. You remember the same earthquake happened to everybody. The boys at the rock saw the angel sitting on the rock. And the boys who were guarding the rock had a different perspective than the ladies who came to the tomb. And the different perspective has to do with the different expectation. See, if we would have advertised this week like nobody knew it was Easter Sunday. Y'all been on Facebook. You know everybody in the world. Everybody. If we would have advertised this Easter Sunday, we have divine healing for liver disease. Very few people with liver disease would have shown up. Because they wouldn't have believed that. But I'm telling you that because you showed up, it doesn't matter if you had liver disease or cancer that you don't know about or a tumor that you don't know about or fatty liver that you don't know about or pancreatic cancer that you don't know about or an ingrown toenail that you do know about it because you're feeling it. While you're showing up, God can say, eliminated, eliminated, annihilated, eliminated, eliminated, eliminated. And it doesn't have to be said, this is the day for this. Because you came expecting that the tomb is empty so your body can be empty from sickness and disease and things that could take you away. Now listen, you don't have to believe that. You don't have to believe that. You just have to live with what you believe. And once you live with what you believe, it begins to flesh out who does and who doesn't. It's not a threat. That's life. What I'm telling you is the God who sent his son to die on the cross, God himself died on the cross for your sin, says to you that no matter what's happened in your life, your greatest days are ahead of you. You just got to get up and walk toward it. The God who created you for his glory and for your gain just said you got to get up and go up toward it, and it's going to happen for you. Well, I just don't believe that. Well, it'll never happen. Promise you, it'll never happen. Only a few times in the Bible did God take somebody from here and put them over there. But it happened. I've always said that when we build another building, I'm going to put wires in the ceiling that on Easter Sunday when I'm preaching, and I say, are you ready to go to heaven? Because it could happen right now. They go, and I'm gone. And watch everybody go, oh my God, it's real. It would just be smoking mirrors. It would be a lie. But ladies and gentlemen, one day, it's going to happen. And one day, there's going to be a lot of wrecks. And one day, there's going to be fields empties. And one day, there's going to be more and more seats empty. And one day, why? Because he said, it's going to happen. And when that happens, we're going to be ready because we've already seen the resurrection. And if you've seen the resurrection, you're going to easily believe he's got something for you. Amen? Now, here's what I say. Affirmation. Wherever you are, be there. Go to the last one, please. I want to show up where God wants me to be so I can do what he wants me to do so I can be who he created me to be. I want to be where God wants me to be so I can do what God wants me to do, so I can be what God wants me to be. And many times, ladies and gentlemen, you don't know why you're there until you're there. And once you're there, you know why you were there. Stand with me. Father, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for the promise of the resurrection. I thank you for the fullness of the joy that we have in knowing that you're alive. You're seated at the right hand of God the Father, and that we have confidence, and that confidence can give us courage, and that courage can give us conviction to believe you are who you say you are. You can do what you say you can do, and you will do it for us. And Father, I come together in agreement with other believers in this house, praying for the supernatural transformation from debt to be released off their life, from disease to be released off their life, from discouragement to be released off their life, in the name of Jesus Christ. It was before the cross that you said, by my stripes, you will be healed. Lord, you've paid for it. We receive it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. Amen. Greet one another on